Good morning. It's good to have you in class today. Welcome to my home. It's a haven for me and for Dale and for a lot of other people too, because we open our home to a lot of people, especially on Sundays when I have a big dinner. But we love our home, and it is a place of rest and comfort. This is a place that I study most times, right here at my kitchen table, that I never use unless it's on Sunday, and every morning when I study. This is where I found out who I was in Christ, because I didn't know who I was in Christ until I started here. And I began to study and I began to learn. And God began to really birth in me a hunger for His Word, a hunger for His people, and a hunger to teach. It was surprising even to me. I'm thinking, how is that possible that He could use somebody like me? But He has. I'm glad that you came to class. I'm glad that you take the time each week to tune in and to listen to me. And I hope that what I say can make a difference in your life, because only the Word of God can change us. My opinions can't change you, can't change me, but God's Word, it will change the world. And so we have to get the Word out. If you know me at all, you know that sometimes I am controversial. In the coming weeks and months, I'm going to teach you some four-out stuff. I'm going to talk about the giants of Genesis 6 and the Nephilim. That's what the word giant is translated into in the Hebrew. Nephilim was translated into giants. I'm going to teach you some stuff about those in the coming months. I'm going to teach you some stuff that your eyebrows is going to raise and you're going to think, what? Where did she get that? And I'm going to show you where I got it. And it's going to be good for you to think out of the box. If there's anything that I'm strong on, it's like, let me think out of the box. There's so many layers to the Word of God. And I've always stayed way up on top. And it was so refreshing for me. It was exciting for me to get down under the surface into the meat of the Word and realize that God has something to say for me every day, but not only for me today, but for our world, for our environment, what's going on around us, in our country, in our nation, in our world. And so it's exciting to me. Today, I'm going to be a little controversial. I'm going to talk about Donald Trump today. I want to talk about, first of all, the blood moons. And if you went to church with us during the blood moons on Wednesday nights for several weeks, we talked about the blood moons and the significance that they had in our world. And you know, if there's a, and let me just tell you, the blood moons happened on April the 15th, 2014, October the 8th, 2014, April the 4th, 2015, and September the 28th, 2015. And you know, they all happened, every one of them, on a Jewish holidays. And remember this, that a sign comes in the Bible. When a sign comes in the Bible, it doesn't necessarily mean that something is going to happen today, but it means that something is starting. Something is starting up. Something's going to happen. It's a sign. It's just like the Star of Bethlehem. You know, if you've seen the Star of Bethlehem way back in Jesus' time, it didn't happen just one day. It happened and for months, and the wise men followed it until Jesus. It fell right over, it was stopped right over where Jesus was born, and it was a sign, and it started at a point and ended at a point. But you know what? If you were there and you seen that star at that point and you thought, oh my goodness, nothing happened. What's going on? Because you know, nothing really happened besides this. A baby was born that they didn't know who it was, and nothing happened in that baby's life for 33 years until he was come into his ministry, was crucified and resurrected. And then if they had enough foresight to look back and think, oh, something did happen. Okay. So it's just like when we went to Pensacola the other day, and we had a wonderful time, just me and Dale, and it was good. But as we traveled with my phone, my GPS, it would say 400 miles to Pensacola. And I'd see a sign up on the road, Pensacola, 400 miles. And I think, oh, GPS is right on. Okay, and it didn't mean that I was there yet. It did mean it was coming, okay? And so then I went 200 miles. I was in Mississippi. I wasn't, come on now, really? Okay, but see, I did get there, and it did, signs precede. And so that's what I want to talk about today, that even the papers are picking up on the signs that something is coming. In a paper, it said the other day, Eclipse 2019. How is Donald Trump linked to the Bible, to the blood moon doomsday prophecy? And it was like, okay, even the signs, even people are picking up on it. Even heathen people are picking up on it. But you know what they're doing? They're trying to make it, ooh, no, it's something bad. Oh, it's doomsday. It's awful stuff. You know, we're the end of the world, blah, blah, blah. And then when nothing does happen, then they begin to gang slay and mock and talk. And they will say, well, we know that Christianity ain't right. Look at that. And they begin to mock. But in doing that, you know what they're doing? They're absolutely confirming scripture. Over in 2 Peter 3 and 3, it says this, knowing first that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own flesh. Well, duh, we got them. And saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep and all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation, for this they were willingly ignorant. Are we there today? Yes, we are. Okay, in Joel 2, it says this in verse 31. For the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord shall come. In Acts 2, now we're talking New Testament, it says in verse 20, the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and notable day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So the first sermon ever preached was right there, and it was by Peter. And what did that sermon contain? That scripture from Joel. Signs in the sky have always been there since the beginning of time. There was a solar eclipse and blood moons. At the time of Jesus' crucifixion, you can go back and time it and you can see it was. Everybody was talking about signs in the sky, and Peter told them, don't you remember what Jesus said, guys? And it was also linked to his second coming, because it said the coming of the Son of a Man. So repent, get your hearts right. Here's the whole point, though. We see the signs, we don't look at it as astrology and guide our lives or live with that. No, we recognize that this. Number one, the word of God is true. Number two, the one who created the stars, the moon, and the sky, he is announcing his second coming. And the more reason to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and as your Lord. No religion, no leader has the ability to time his events and his timetable with the sun, moon, and the stars. Everything is pointing to Jesus Christ our Lord. Remember it says in Revelation 6 and 12, and I beheld when he opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. It's the timing and the combination of the events that you begin to see this, the very fingerprint of God. And you need to know this too. There is no such thing as coincidence, because people will say, well, that's just coincidence. Well, the Jewish rabbis says that coincidence is not a kosher term, and it's not. There's no such thing as coincidence. There is no such thing as, oh, that's just happenstance. No. God has a divine plan, a divine timetable set up, and he has a divine appointment coming out, and everything is for a reason, and you have to look at that. Now the devil also, he's got a divine timetable too, because he knows that he's just got a small amount of time, and so he's got to work and he's got to divert the plan of God all the time. That's his gold all the time. Okay, so here we go. We're going to talk about Donald Trump. Let me give you some facts. Donald Trump's birthday is June the 14th, 1948. Did you know that on the night that Donald Trump was born, it was a blood moon? Okay. But now here's another thing. numbers is big to God. Always know that numbers is a big deal to God. If you don't believe so, you go through the Bible and you start to look and you'll find numbers and you'll find coexisting numbers, the same ones. Seven is God's number. It's the number of completion, 7 days it took to create the heaven and the earth. So seven is a big number with God. And if you add 700 days to the birth of Donald Trump, you know what that date would be? Friday, May the 14th, 1948. Do you know what that day is? That's the birth of the Israel nation once again. Did you know that there was a solar eclipse on May the 9th, 1948, just days before that Israel became a nation? See, there's signs. It's pointing towards something. Trump, in January the 20th, 2016, he won the presidency of the United States. And at the age of, get this, 70 years, 7 months, and 7 days is when he got that. Do you think that's happenstance? There ain't no happenstance. Do you think that's a God thing? Uh-huh. I'm making you think out of the box. Do you understand where I'm going? Trump recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Jerusalem on the 70th birthday of the nation. Do you think that's coincidence? Mm-mm. Okay, it was there. He was there before the nation happened, and he was there as president. He was there as president to recognize Jerusalem as the capital on his 70th anniversary, as if no one had ever wanted to do that before, which they had, and they've talked about it. But why didn't they do it? Because God had a timetable. He restrained people from doing it. God says, I want it to be on my 70th anniversary, and I want my chosen leader to do it. And he will be like a trump. God has a play on words, doesn't he? Because Trump has been like a trumpet, hasn't he? And Trump, his first term will be marked by a lunar eclipse, exactly halfway through, and it was. So when you see all these things happening, and when you know these things, it's no coincidence. God's up to something. Okay, so God puts this man in office for this purpose, and something prophetically is happening even now. We may not see it yet, because when the blood moons happened, I bet you I heard so many people say, well, there didn't nothing happen. I guess you all were just wrong. Let me tell you, something happened. And I'm going to give you some, for instances of this, if I've got enough time. If you want to be accepted, you have the free choice, because God gives you and I free choice. We can decide what we want to believe and what we don't want to believe. But you need to remember this. Everything that we do, everything that we believe, there's going to be consequences to what we believe, good or bad. If we're going to line up with God's word, there's going to be good consequences. If we go against and be a skeptic against what God is doing, there's going to be consequences. So when we die and we go before the Father and we say, well, we didn't know. There wasn't any sign. We didn't know anything. And nothing was ever spoken to us. And God's going to say, listen, buddy, I put it in the sky. I wrote it in the sky. I showed you signs in the sky, but you chose not to believe it. I put it in my word, but you chose not to read it. I put it in the mouth of my prophets, but you chose not to listen to it. God forbid, we don't want to be that person. No. So what kind of events should a Bible believer look for confirmation that these series of blood moons refer to something? Here's a list of unprecedented events. Number one, Trump becomes the first U.S. president to visit the Western Wall. Never been done before. It's the closest point to the Holy of Holies, the temple of God. Number two, Trump recognizes Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, which led to Honduras, Guatemala, Australia recognizing Jerusalem as the capital also. 3 days after Trump is inaugurated on January the 20th, 2017, on the 23rd, he blocks foreign aid for abortion. And that's an answer to Christians' prayers. Was that the devil? Did he do the devil's bidding there? No, the devil wants to kill, steal, and destroy, but God comes to give life and life and more abundant. So that's an answer to Christians' prayers. He blocked that aid for millions of babies to not be aborted again. 100 millions of dollars stopped flowing into the nonprofit organizations then, okay? and they were working against God's laws. It needed stopped. Trump did that. Did we hear a lot about it? No, just from the abortionists who wanted it to continue. But did the people of God raise up and say, oh, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus? Well, we need to, because that was a major thing. The second thing, January the 31st, 2017, he nominates that Neil Gorsuch to the Supreme Court as justice. A promise made, promise kept. On February the 7th, 2017, he saved $700 million in the cost for F-35 fighter jets. Well, if he hadn't have saved that $700 million, where's that $700 million going to go? It cost that to build the plane. But what about that surplus $700 million? That's going to go to lobbyists, politicians, buy-offs. It's going to pad the pockets of people. But Trump, he saved us $700 million. The fourth thing was in February the 22nd, 2017, Trump revoked the transgender bathrooms in the public schools. Do you think that's a God thing? Well, yes, I do. What do you think? Isn't that what you prayed for and I prayed for? It didn't need to be? What do you think about my little grandchildren going in? Come on now. Let's get serious. How many Christians are happy and pleased that that was done away with? Children are put into schools not to indoctrinate, not to lead them one way or the other, but they are meant to be instruction. Come on now. People say, how can God use this man? What has he done? What has he done? Well, let me ask you this. Could you have done what he's done so far? What have you done in the last 2 years? Can you do a better job than what he's doing? Is it irrational, emotional hatred spread by the devil that's coming against him? Do I think he's a perfect man? Nope. Do I think that he's got a lot of issues that he needs to get under the blood of Jesus? Yep. Do I even know if he's a Christian? Not 100%. No, I don't know. But do I think that God can use him? I sure do. God used an ass in Balaam's time. He used an ass to speak. Listen, he can use anybody. If he can use an animal, he can use anybody. He can even use me. That's why I'm here with you today. The next thing was this. The Wall Street Journal, which hates Trump, had to admit on April the 17th, 2017, that Trump is rolling back more regulations than any president in history. In 2017, April the 26th, he launched Victim of Immigration Crime Engagement Office that supported victims of crime by illegal aliens. And the illegal aliens who were coming in are still coming in, killing, raping, abusing, beheading. He made an office to stop that, okay? And April the 28th, 2017, Neil Gorsuch, he is put in as Supreme Court Justice, praise God, a conservative, a lifetime appointment in there. On June the 1st, 2017, he withdrew from the Paris Climate Accord. And you know, he took flack over that. All the mainstream media said he was a terrible guy. He's against the green religion they're trying to create. Well, I'm saying, thank God. But you know what happened with that? And that's really interesting. You should go over on your iPhones and you start in looking at the yellow vest movement over in France. And he was trying to, this president over there, and this, he was trying to promote this climate, this carbon emissions. He was going to make this president, what's his name? Macron. President Macron. He said, he's over this, and he said, I am going to make my people of France, you're going to foot this bill for this, because this is going to be. And when Trump pulled out of that, man, people just hated him. And then Macron's people in France, they had a little revolution going on. Get on your web and start looking at that. They begin to wear yellow vests and they begin to stand up, and they were conservatives standing up saying, no, we will not support this. This is not right. We will not do this. And I'm telling you, they had unrest. They had their military police state almost. They would send people, their police out, and they'd taken away their guns. Here they come. And there was even a story on the web about a woman with a yellow vest pushing her baby carriage miscarriage, and the police said, we don't like what you got on. We're going to take you to the cops. We're going to take you to jail right now. And they pulled the baby forcibly out of her arms, took her to jail because she didn't approve. She didn't have the same opinion as what the government did. Can you see that happening in the United States? Could that happen in the United States? If they take our guns away, could that happen in the United States? Could it? Yes, it could. It sure could. But you know what France did? They rose up and they threw a fit and they said no. And you know what? It's been, that was started out in like a long time ago, like in 2010. And it just, this past December 2018, finally President Macron said, well, you don't have to do it. I'm going to take that out because all hell hit the fan. That's what happened. And he had to back down and they got their way because they stood up. Praise God for people that will stand up. So was Trump right for pulling out? Yes, sir. Trump was right for pulling out of that mess. All right. Let's see. What else? Oh, my goodness. I preached all that, and let me go on to the next. August the 25th, 2017, he imposed economic sanctions on Venezuela. This corrupt socialist nation took a prosperous oil producer straight down. It was so wicked. And they said, we will give you everything for free. Everything, everything, everybody will be equal. But let me tell you this, if we are to have freedom, we can't be equal because I'm not going to make the same decisions that you'd make. So it's not going to work. And if you go on the line and look at Venezuela, you can see that they're in a revolution too. Their grocery stores are empty. They're hungry. They're fighting. They have no guns. They have, come on now, let's get a grip. On September the 5th, 2017, Trump revoked the Anchor Baby policy, or DACA, Delayed Action in Childhood Arrival, license against human trafficking. Trump, he was attacking human trafficking, and they take women in, abuse them, and if that's not enough, they bring the children in and start with that. And it's easier to kidnap a child anyway, bring them in and make money. America, the liberals say, well, if a baby comes in, we can't do anything. Delayed action means no action. People sell their children to traffickers. And he said no. Okay, that was a godly thing, was it not? September the 21st, 2017, he made sanctions against North Korea. Oh boy, did that start a big, oh my gosh, we're gonna get bombed. And everybody was saying, oh, he's gonna start World War III. Anytime Trump does anything, it's impending chaos to the media. And it never gives a contrasting the other side. Never, it's always biased. October the 12th, 2017, the FBI recovered underage victims of human trafficking in Operation Crisscross Country. October the 15th, he secured the release of three athletes from China. October the 24th, America released 77 million acres for oil and gas drilling in the Gulf of Mexico, making America one of the largest oil producers in the world, which is why the price of oil and gas have come down. And we have been held hostage by the drug cartel all this time in our past. But, you know, they jacked up the prices so that they could get richer and richer and richer. And we said for years, why don't we drill in our own country? Why don't we drill? But no, the politicians said, no, we're not going to do that. Think out of the box. Start asking questions. Why? Why don't they do that? Why are they not doing that? We've got to get wise as serpents, harmless as doves. Trump said, we're going to change that. And they didn't. So he said, no problem. We'll just produce our own oil in America. October the 26th, 2017, the IRS is the most feared organization in America. The Internal Revenue Service strikes fear in the hearts of everybody. And many use their power for corruption. And there's good IRS agents, I know that, but many are corrupt. But on October the 26th, 2017, the IRS was made accountable for targeting conservative Tea Party groups, such as religious groups, because before we were targeted, okay? But he said, he stood up for Christians all over America and said, nope, we're not going to have that. Well, they didn't like it. They didn't like it, but we got her done. On November the 9th, 2017, Trump negotiated for a $250 million trade deal with China. 2017, November the 17th, the U.S. prices retook the U.S. forces retook Raqqa, the last city that ISIS had, he went in and absolutely took back. He obliterated it. Now, how come that Obama couldn't do that in his 8 years, but Trump did it within, what, less than a year? How come? What was that? Matter of fact, when you go online and you start researching it, you will see that Obama sent out, dropped leaflets down on them before that he bombed them to let them know if there was any children or women there that they needed to get them out because America was going to bomb them. Well, gee, wasn't that nice? No wonder we couldn't close them down. I'm going to stop here with my facts. I'm going to pick up again the next time and just let you know. No, I'm not. I'm just going to finish real fast and tell you. I've got a, no, I ain't. I'm going to finish next time, okay? Because I don't want you to miss anything. I want you to know that there is an agenda out there to destroy America. And I know that he's Obama. I know, I'm going to talk about Trump. I know Trump has a lot of issues, but Trump is God's man in this time. Think what our world would have been like if Hillary was our president now. Think out of the box. Quit using your emotions. Use your Bible instead, Christian. It's time that we woke up to the truth. Oh, goodness. Think. Now I want to close out and just tell you this. If you don't have a church home, we want you. We want you to be where God wants you to be. I want you to pray about it. Is God leading you to Word of Faith Family? If He is, why aren't you there? If you've been thinking about it all this time, maybe you've been thinking about it since you were a kid. I need to be at Word of Faith. I'm telling you today, today's the day. You need to be at Word of Faith Family. I invite you there. We're a family. We love each other. We hold each other up. When you have a problem, we have a problem. When you rejoice, we rejoice. It's the way the Bible set up the church. The church was made for unity. The church was made for support. The church was made for instruction. The church was made for discipleship. That's what we do. And we'd love to have you. Our services in 2 weeks are going to change. We're going to start the 1st of February. We're going to start at 10:30 in the morning. And we're going to have worship. We're going to have preaching. And I'm telling you, things are going to change. Things are going to be wonderful. We're excited about what God's doing at Word of Faith. We're excited about the Word of God that comes alive in us. We're excited about what God is doing in our children and our children's children. We have a children's church. You need to come. We've got a place for your babies. We've got a place for you. We want you there. Let me pray with you, okay? Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that we would be smart, Lord, that we would be loving, would we would be kind. But, Father, we wouldn't be mealy-mouthed. But, Father, we would be like you, bold. We would be loving. We would be truthful. Lord, I pray, God, that you would take this word that I've spoken today and people would think, I'm going to listen to that. I'm going to write them dates down. I'm going to check her out. I'm going to see if what she said is true. Father, Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to teach. I thank you for an opportunity, Lord, to get the word out to people. And I praise you, Father. I pray that you would touch their hearts and change their minds. And I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in me. I praise you in Jesus' name. Now I'll see you next week for the conclusion of this message. And I'll see you in my home. It was wonderful having you. Thank you so much. We'll see you next week.